Well, tonight is our Safe and Sound webinar, and we have a very special guest. Tonight, we're talking about Bowers and Wilkins, and my special guest is Andy Kerr. And tonight, we'll be talking about a few different things about Bowers and Wilkins. It was founded in 1966 by John Bowers, and it's grown into a global brand that's one of the most iconic high-end audio loudspeaker manufacturers in the world. So tonight, Andy will have a brief kind of talk about the company's humble beginnings, and then we'll move into some loudspeaker basics, including setup, Bowers and Wilkins design philosophy, and how this is realized in their wide range of speakers that includes bookshelves, stand mount, and floor standing. Andy will also answer questions from our Patreon member attendees at the end of the presentation. So if you have a question at any time during our presentation, you can always go to the bottom. There's a little Q&A icon there with a speech bubble, and you just type in your question and our moderator, Alan, will liaise with you and we'll handle all questions at the end. So without further ado, thank you, Andy, for being our very special guest today.
You're very welcome, Colleen. Thanks very much for having me on.
It's just wonderful. Now, this is a beautiful room that you're in, and I believe you are probably at Company HQ in Worthing?
Yeah, that's right. So this is one of our listening rooms here. We have multiples in this facility. This is, obviously at the moment, probably not our visitor center. There aren't many visitors coming in, unfortunately, right now, but normally this is where we would host visitors. We'd bring them in here as part and parcel of their introduction to the brand, where they have the opportunity to listen to lots of different product, hopefully learn a bit about who we are, what we do, and maybe we take them to our factory. Our factory is, I guess, about 400 feet from where I'm sitting right now, just in that direction. So it's kind of a great HQ hub. This isn't where we do our R&D. Our R&D center's about 14 miles from here in Southwater.
So why Worthing?
Okay, good question. So why Worthing? John Bowers was born in Worthing. It's like a lot of the audio industry, I guess. I think you could probably find, I don't know, 10, 12 brands that have a similar kind of backstory, that the origination is one guy, one particular person with an idea. In our particular case, it's John George Frederick Bowers, who was born in Worthing in 1922. And after the war ended, he decided he was going to found an audio company, and that's kind of where it went from there. He had this amazing, very distinctive kind of early life, formative year. He was an amateur radio enthusiast before the war broke out. As the war obviously unfortunately happened, 1939, he joined the Royal Corps of Signals because of his interest in radio. And then from there, he was recruited pretty quickly into British military intelligence. He actually wound up, genuine story, in MI6, specifically in MI6 Section 8. So obviously most of us who have been around the company for a while quite like the idea that the founder of the company was in the same Department of Intelligence as James Bond. He didn't have the car, no Aston Martins, but he was based at a place called Waddenhall, which is a bit like Bletchley Park, and their job was to listen to radio traffic, in particular communicate with resistance fighters and also with spies. So all of that background and all of that knowledge and all of that interest in audio, because clearly that was his role during the war, led him to kind of pursue it afterwards. People always ask, okay, well, that's John Bowers. Where's the Wilkins bit come from? His best friend, a guy he got to know whilst in service at Waddenhall, was a chap called Roy Wilkins, and the two guys founded the company together after the war. So that's where that comes from.
And they did a lot of their own develops. Didn't he start off with a £10,000 donation from a client?
Yeah, so John was a kind of dedicated music enthusiast rather than a qualified engineer. I mean, he was, as I say, interested in radio, but actually hadn't got any formal engineering qualifications. He actually put himself through night school in Brighton whilst working during the day in the shop that he and Roy ran. And developed an interest in what was going on inside the loudspeakers and other products that he was selling. You might not know, but it was reasonably commonplace in the 50s and 60s for audio components to be shipped as flat pack components. And the reason for that, of course, is it reduced the overall shipping weight and that took the cost down. And then the dealer would put them together. I mean, in those days, they were probably like simpler components and devices than they are today. So he obviously learned a lot in doing that as well. He's essentially looking inside the products as he's putting them together and kind of going, well, I wouldn't do that. And I wouldn't do that. And eventually it turned into a kind of sideline business, if you like. So you could, if you spoke very nicely to Mr. Bowers, buy a modified version of a conventional pair of loudspeakers that he'd hot-rodded specifically for you. And a lady called Kathleen Knight, who was an opera singer living in the Worthing area, had purchased a pair of these speakers, had been very taken with the sound of these speakers, and in the end wrote him into her will. Very sadly for her, she passed away in 1966. And part of her bequest was this significant sum of money. I'm not quite sure it was as much as you say. There's all sorts of different versions of the amount that I've heard. It's definitely a good sum, though. But on the proviso that he used it to go and start a business, which is essentially duly what he did. So he left Roy running the shop. The shop carried on. And John went off and founded Bowers and Wilkins, or B&W Electronics, as it was called then, which then eventually became B&W Loudspeakers and is now what we are today, Bowers and Wilkins.
And there's some great early designs from Bowers and Wilkins. Do you want to show us a few? I think they look so modern already. You know, I think you were showing me one earlier. It's a very beautiful.
Yeah, well, I mean, John, the guys are kind of always been a visionary. And I think that right back to the earliest days, I mean, one of the things that we're most known for today, and I'll bring this one up, is just because it's like a perfect example of our willingness to be somewhat different and interesting, is that one. That's the Nautilus. Some of you guys might have seen that, I'm sure. You might be familiar with it. I know people obviously never believe it when I say this, because they always think that's just a wacky shape, right? They think that's just something that somebody drew as a pen sketch and then tried to turn it into a loudspeaker. But there are genuine sound acoustic reasons. Sorry, that's not meant to be a pun. Solid acoustic reasons as to why it's the shape that it is. Why it is the form that it is. And that goes all the way back to the earliest days. JB was very big on the idea that loudspeakers had to have a form that always followed function. So if we wanted to embrace interesting shapes and interesting ideas, that was okay. And the company, as you said, came up with a whole series of very innovative and different ideas, not least of which is this one.
Absolutely. I mean, even the early days too, I was thinking, and when you showed me some of those early designs, they looked so modern. And you were saying that many people today still want to buy those original Bowers and Wilkins.
Very much so. We have a kind of a following on our Facebook pages, of course, of, you know, keen audiophile guys. And one of the most interesting things we find is the reaction that we get when we post some of these old pictures. I mean, these are models that have been out of production for years. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people come up with that exact line. Hey, if you made a thousand of those, we'd buy them. You know, we'd sell them, you know, easily. Of course, you know, you don't necessarily want to be that company that just makes retro product and nothing else. But it's always been quite a flattering thing.
Absolutely. Well, why don't we talk about a few things before we get into specific designs with specific ranges of Bowers and Wilkins loudspeakers. What is it that people should listen out for or not listen out for when purchasing loudspeakers or setting up loudspeakers in the room? What is the criterion by which to judge how a loudspeaker performs?
Can you
first hear them maybe now? Sonically and then maybe efficiency and everything else?
Okay, great. Oh, wow, okay, big topic. Listen, the thing I always say to anybody when they're joining the company, the primary question is, why do you buy a pair of loudspeakers, right? And the answer, or the correct answer, is to listen to music. It's not to listen to loudspeakers. So that's the thing that we never forget, you know, from an engineering point of view, from a technical and product point of view. And that's very much the target that we're trying to drive towards. As far as is possible, the things that are in the room with you, whether they're something like, you know, these guys over my shoulder here, which these are 800s, or it's something more affordable, should disappear. As far as you possibly can make it happen, it should disappear. The sound stage, as we refer to it, or the image, if you prefer, or the presence of the music between the speakers floating in free space, is the target, and the devices that reproduce it should essentially recede into the background. You shouldn't be aware of them. Now, of course, it's hard to achieve, and there are multiple different reasons why. But that's for ultimately what I would say if you were, you know, to go to a good dealer. Of course, again, it might be difficult for you to do that at the moment because of what's going on. But let's say in a perfect world, you can still go to a dealer, and we certainly always recommend that you do. That's always what the intent should be. Have an experience where you come away afterwards thinking, wow, that music was great. Obviously, if you're going to spend a lot of money, you're probably mentally, subjectively trying to categorize certain things like, you know, can I feel the bass presence, or can I you know, do I find the treble grating or not, wherever it might be. But ultimately, the transcendental moment, the perfect moment, is when you're not thinking about any of that stuff at all, and instead you've got Miles Davis in the room with you. That's, or whomsoever it might be, that's your particular poison. Do you see my point? So create the illusion of reality as best as you possibly can. We refer to it as true sound. I mean, every company has their own version of what they're talking about, but essentially that's the thing. But that's certainly what we're trying to achieve. Now, how do you do it? Everything comes into play. Where do you want me to start? We can talk about the room, or we can talk about the camp.
Room. Yeah, okay. Maybe a room, and then we can do loudspeaker placement, and then we can go into the specifics of Bowers and Wilkins' design philosophy.
Sure, okay. Right, look, let's start with the room. So you don't have to have an acoustically treated listening room. I mean, who does, right? Apart from people in my profession. Of course you don't. We recognize that reality, but you can still achieve a lot more than you might think by thinking about where the speakers go in the room. In fact, it's one of the probably least understood and most influential factors in getting a good result in the room that you happen to be in, wherever that might be. Now, you can start with room parameters, room dimensions. Fundamentally, a square room in all directions is probably the most challenging space you could possibly put something into, because the bass in particular will have all sorts of issues in that space. So a rectangular room is infinitely more desirable. I mean, there are certain ratios that one can use. If you want to get into that, you can talk about a ratio of one high to 1.6 wide to 2.5 long, roughly. If you put that in feet, that's like 8 feet high, 13 feet wide and 20 feet long. I mean, you know, obviously different rooms, different sizes, but rectangular rooms tend to be much more forgiving in how they behave. And that's because of the way that bass in particular behaves inside a room. So if you've got doubts about how that could work from your perspective, if you've got speakers where, you know, the room is this orientation and the speakers are going down the length of the room, you're probably much more likely to get something that works. Probably the least effective solution would be, like I said, a square room, or perhaps with a sofa hard up against the wall. That would be another problem area as well, because the bass that you're generating in that room is going to interact with the wall and the boundary behind you, and it's going to get exacerbated.
And that's exactly what we have in our living room, actually. So we have just an acoustic panel, just like you have. I think acoustic panels are probably worth speaking about as well.
They can be. I mean, I think before I get to that, because I want to just, there are some other real simple ones that I think often are perhaps misunderstood, like a bit of free space around the speakers. You know, try and get them off the wall if you can. Not always possible, and we recognize that, but if you can, it makes a difference. Try and get them at equal distances from your seat, again, if you can. If you think about what the end result here is, you're trying to, like I said, create that illusion of the performers on the stage, let's say. Now, if you've got one speaker closer to you than the other one, then that stage is automatically skewed in that direction. That's just one obvious example. If you've got one speaker higher up than the other one, the same thing applies. If you've got this kind of classic scenario that you see in all those lifestyle mags, you know, where there's a speaker on the floor, and there's another one up here on a shelf or a cabinet. What you've essentially got is the bass guitarist and perhaps the lead guitarist standing on the stage, and the drummer's kind of suspended 20 feet up in the air. And clearly that's weird, right? So speakers at the same height and the same distance off the wall and the same distance to your seat is really gonna help. Height off the floor is always good. Of course, with a tower or a floor standing loudspeaker, that's pretty straightforward because they come at a set height. With models that sit on stands, try and think about, or could be put on stands, try and think about them roughly where your ears are. Essentially speaking, what we're trying to do is replicate the sense of a real performer in the room. Now, if you accept that a real performer in the room is probably somewhere in the height range of, I don't know, 4'11" to 6'3", unless they're unusually short or unusually tall, then the sound image that we're trying to reproduce probably wants to be roughly in that band. And if you take that speaker and you set it on the floor, you're taking that band and you're putting that down on the floor as well. So essentially you're now listening to a performer that's lying on the floor, which may be what they were doing when they were recording, could but be. Probably is a fair chance that
maybe
they were.
Maybe in the late 60s, possibly.
Yeah, exactly. So what we're trying to is just get it to think about speaker placement in the terms of, can I get as close to the idea that when they're playing and working, I can visualize somebody standing in front of me between the two speakers singing or playing or both. And if I can get that, I'm on the right lines. After that point, okay, you asked about acoustics. It's really important that you don't go too far down this line or overstress about this thing. As I say, I think one of the biggest mistakes that the hi-fi industry goes into sometimes is putting people off by making them worry too much about this.
Yeah.
It's clearly obvious when you think about it, that a really bright, reflective room with like full-length glass windows at one end and a really polished floor and hardly anything on the walls is going to be a great reflective surface that sound can bounce off all over the place. Just makes sense. Mm-hmm. So some things that can kind of help damp that a little bit and control that a little bit in some way, shape or form are good, are desirable. Now you don't have to go to town on it. What we don't want is to create the alternative effect of that, where the room is so dead that everything sounds a bit like this, sounds a bit kind of closed down, because that's what a recording studio sounds like. We don't want that. So it's a kind of natural sense of the voice having a bit of reverb and a bit of space and a bit of air. And you can achieve that with bookshelves and furniture and a rug on the floor and curtains. You don't have to have dedicated, expensive acoustic treatments and stuff. The reason we have these most of the time, by the way, is because we don't have to dust them, unlike books, you know, which clearly you do. So it's just about producing something that's consistent and repeatable. But also, like I say, very importantly, real. Ultimately, the worst thing you can do in the world is either talk yourself out of buying a decent pair of loudspeakers because you don't want to go through the stress of sorting out the room, or convincing your friends that it's just too much hassle. Most speakers will work in most rooms with 5 minutes of thought, and you'll probably get decent results. Give it 10 minutes of thought and you'll get great results. And that's as simple as that.
I think that it's also just a whole process. It's a long process. It's almost like a lifelong process, you know, little tweaks here and there of what you can do. You don't really just dive in the whole way and the whole, then you have the best sound system that you'll ever have in one moment. You're constantly tweaking, trying out new things, trying different placements of your loudspeakers, towing it in a little bit. But, you know, it is a whole process, which is quite enjoyable, actually. And it can go on for years and years and decades, even.
It can be. I mean, again, if you think about the amount of effort, it always fascinates me, the amount of effort that some people put into other facets of life, but perhaps don't put into audio. And actually, when it's done right, it can be so remarkably rewarding. Like I said earlier on, I get back to this point. If you've got the perfectly set up, amazing audio system, and you've only got 6 records, you're missing the point. Right? It should be the other way around. If you've got that music collection like the one that's behind you and you haven't got an audio system, then I want to know why. Because, you know, that's the missing link that makes that collection come to life and takes all those wonderful performers and transcends everything that they achieved back in the 50s and 60s and 70s and 80s and just brings it into your space with you every day. And that's so rewarding when it's done right, because, well, again, you know, I go back to the earlier point. Why should you buy a pair of loudspeakers? Because you want to listen to music, mm-hmm. and you want to discover new things, and you want to get, I don't know. I mean, I talk about this all the time, that the whole point of listening to music in my head is you want to have your emotional state changed. It's not always for the better. Sometimes it's actually for the worse. You know, you could be in a great mood and, you know, sometimes some track will come on and all of a sudden you feel, I don't know, melancholy, or mm-hmm. you feel angry, or you feel, alternatively, you feel uplifted. But audio systems, when they're done right, will help that effect massively. They'll take something that was already brilliant and make it unbelievable. They'll take it to a different level. In that same way, as you always remember that great gig that you went to, and it was the same performer that you saw 20 times, but on that one night, they had that amazing magical connection with the crowd. The whole room came alive. Mm-hmm. And everybody came away afterwards saying, what an amazing night, what an amazing performance. Now, that's the same set of sound being generated by the same sets of people, but in that specific space. And I guess that's what we're trying to achieve with loudspeakers as well, in your home.
Absolutely. It just becomes an emotional experience. And this is one of the reasons, one of the key facets of Classic Album Sundays when I started it 10 years ago, was encouraging people to hear music in a deeper way, whether it's contextually with the story, but also sonically as well, and really hearing those details and just being able to be immersed into a recording in the way the artist intended. Well, we've kind of gone through, you know, what we should look for at a loudspeaker, room acoustics. We've gone through speaker placement. But one last question, and I know this can be quite a scientific question, so just maybe a quick talk through. How do you dial in a speaker? What does that even mean?
So you'll be surprised to learn really quite small differences can make quite a substantial difference. So for example, if you think that the speed of sound is a constant, varies with altitude, but the speed of sound is a constant. So you've got two loudspeakers at a set distance from here and here to your ears, mm-hmm. and you're sitting in the chair, and one of them is, let's say, 10 centimeters further behind the line of the other one. So they're not quite in exactly the right position. Now, the end point of the job that we're trying to achieve is that our sounds are coming from two separate locations, left and right loudspeaker, and then we're trying to make it arrive at your ears in what we call time alignment, in the perfect time alignment, so that the end, your brain is fooled into believing that rather than coming from here and here, the sound is coming from here. Let's talk about, we always dial in with a single source instrument, so a piano or a voice or a guitar, whatever it might be, because that's a single point source of sound in real space originally created. So if those speakers are slightly out, the sound from one speaker will arrive at your ear slightly ahead of the other one. And the end game is that that image won't be so correctly resolved. It won't be so precise, because your brain will go, I can hang on a minute. It's not coming from one place. It's coming from two. And your brain's remarkably good at that. It's very, very good at that, with your combination of ears and brain. So the devil is in the detail. If you really want to go to town on dialing speakers in, it's not roughly in the same place. It's in the same place, measured precisely. It's not roughly towed in. It's towed in. It's simple little details as well. You can account for variations in the listener's height. For example, I'm reasonably tall. I'm not massively tall. I'm 6'3". So you could tilt the speaker back ever so slightly using the spikes. It's called rake. Just tilt it back ever so slightly to more accurately point the image point between the tweeter and the mid-range cone at my ear. And that would bring the sound stage slightly up and get a more concrete sense of presence and sound at exactly the center of the image. So things like that can make, I say, a huge difference. They're not actually expensive. They're just time consuming. It's a tape measure. Ideally a tape measure and a friend, so that you stay in your seat and somebody else does the hard work for you.
Absolutely. And close your eyes too.
Yeah. Oh, God.
Closing your eyes is a really good thing to do when you're listening to audio.
It certainly helps, but that's down to primal stuff. That's diurnal shift. So we sit there in the tree as the ape going, what the hell's going on out there and how do we stay alive? And our brain takes some of the energy that used to feed our eyesight during the daylight hours, and it turns up our hearing to help us kind of stay alive and cope. So yeah, your acuity increases if you close your eyes, because your brain's trying to go into a bit of survival mode. That's also why, you don't have to do this by the way, but that's also why really hardcore audiophiles often listen late at night, because the outside world noise floor drops and other stuff happens to mains, electricity and stuff. But that's really hardcore, and I, you know, don't go down that road. Just play the music you want to play when you want to play it, and just enjoy it would be, you know, I mean, I'm not saying we don't do that, by the way, but just, you know, don't stress about it either.
I got to get up at 3 a.m. so I can listen to.
Yeah. No.
No, you don't need to do that. Well, why don't we get into Bowers and Wilkins' design philosophy? I mean, the designs, the aesthetic is obviously gorgeous, and we'll get into chassis in a minute. But what I'm thinking more about right now is just kind of going through the basic loudspeaker parts. You were mentioning cones earlier. Some of our viewers may not know what that is.
Sure. So, well, you can obviously, let's look at the speaker over my shoulder. You can see right here. Okay. So the assembly right at the top, is, we refer to, hi-fi has some great language sometimes. It's called a tweeter. Mm-hmm. It does high frequency. Now what does that mean? So, the analogy I sometimes use to help people who aren't quite clear on all of that is, if you were to try and think about a loudspeaker like this as a series of different birds, if that doesn't sound too weird. So if you think about a hummingbird, it has fairly small wings that move very rapidly. And you know, you all know, you've seen natural history programs, the end result of that is it creates a reasonably high-pitched buzz sound. Obviously, a fly does it even more so. That's a tweeter. That's something small moving at high frequency. I'll explain why we do it that way in a minute. As you move downwards through the loudspeaker, you can see each cone size gets progressively larger. In this particular case, this loudspeaker has high frequency, mid-range, and bass. Some speakers don't, they just have two, but this particular one has all three. So the mid-range is that middle area, the vocal area. It's that large silver cone you can see over there. One of the least known ones in hi-fi language. It's not commonly used anymore. It's actually called a squawker, believe it or not.
Squawker.
A squawker. I know. Crazy. No one knows it, but most people just call it a mid-range cone. And that does that predominantly vocal range area, so which is actually a really large range of frequencies. So that's why it's a substantial cone, and there are specifics about why it works the way that it works. Again, I can go into those in a minute. The largest lower section is the one that's tasked with moving the most air. To go back to our bird analogy, if you think about something like an albatross, obviously has a huge wingspan, the very big wings move very slowly, but they generate that huge amount of air beating, kind of swooshing sound. That's low frequency. Also known in cone terms as a woofer. So tweeter, squawker, and woofer, like I said, hi-fi, eh? And what that's supposed to do is generate bass. That's the low frequency. That's the deep sounds that you feel and that kind of create presence in the room that really engages, particularly, obviously, things like orchestral, electronic, hip-hop, whatever it might be. So why do three separate cones would be the first question I'm sure you're going to ask. And the reason for that is because it's about optimization for task, fundamentally. You could attempt to try and replicate the complete frequency range of one. However, it's, in our view, not optimal, and most loudspeaker brands agree with that perspective. It's not optimal for the simple reason that taking something that's big and is designed to move a lot of air, and then asking it to move very rapidly, in other words, at high frequency, inevitably has some compromises. And imagine taking that albatross wing and then flapping it as fast as a hummingbird's wing. You can imagine how messy that would get, right? So the reason being essentially that big things that move lots of air, it tend to get into stress modes. They intend to start to bend and wobble and distort if you move them faster. So what we do, and what most loudspeaker brands do in the same way, is separate the task up into cone areas, cone sizes that are optimal for the job. So if you want something that's going to move very fast, use something small, a tweeter, hummingbird's wing. And if you want to move a lot of air, you need to move something large. And that's the woofer, the deep cone. And then the air in the middle is that mid-range cone that I mentioned before. Now, remember, the entire audio signal still arrives to the loudspeaker as one continuous piece of content with all of the sound, the deep sounds and the high sounds and also those mid-range sounds. So when it gets to the loudspeaker, we need to separate it out into the right constituent elements to be sent to each cone, or if you like, fed to each bird. Bear with me on that one. So what we do is use a series of electronic filters. And those electronic filters essentially take constituent elements of the sound signal, deep sounds, mid-range sounds, high-frequency sounds, and pass them only to the correct cone. Now, clearly, you don't want to have a gap in that continuous whole sound from low to high. If you did, you'd notice it. So there has to be a point where the sound crosses over from one cone to the next. And that point is called a crossover point, which is why these filters are quite often referred to as crossovers. But fundamentally, that's what they're doing. They're taking the complete musical signal, dividing it up to the right cone that's optimal for the job, and then ensuring that all the information gets there with the least possible loss. How's that?
That's a fantastic, fantastic explanation. You really walked people through that. Great analogies. So I'm looking at these lovely 800s over your shoulder. And one thing about Bowers and Wilkins is the designs are often very sexy. If you look at the Nautilus, I mean, it's just an amazing, amazing, it's a piece of art. It really is a piece of art. And some people might think, oh, well, that's beautiful style, but is that really integral to the actual design? So we were speaking about this earlier. I would love for you to tell people about how the actual, it's not form over function, is it? This style is completely integrated into the design philosophy.
Yeah, so look, I mean, okay, we've established that we've got cones and that they move in some cases quite rapidly, and in other cases, they're quite big. Now, if you took anything that's moving and you put it inside some form of structure and some form of box, and then you rigidly mount it in there, it's just inevitable that that movement of that cone is going to translate some of its energy into vibration in the box. And if you're thinking about that in other terms, I mean, I'm speaking right now, and if I put my hand on my chest cavity like this, I can feel some of the sounds that I'm making as they go forward into the room are actually resonating and vibrating through my chest. And you can find 101 different analogies that will do the same thing. An obvious example is if anybody plays a guitar or the piano or the violin, you can feel the wood of the instrument responding when you play a note. And that's the same thing. So we don't want that to happen in loudspeaker design. In a loudspeaker design, the only thing that we want to make any sound are those cones. We don't want any form of contribution effect from the cabinet. Now, it's incredibly hard to achieve. And essentially, the more scope we have to use complex processes, materials, shapes, and forms, the better the chances we have of reducing the effect. The other thing at the same time that we can also have is an effect called cabinet diffraction. Now, what that essentially means is if you put a cone inside the front of a regular wooden box, some of the energy from that cone will travel along the edges of the wooden box before moving out into the room. And you can hear that. And if you're not quite sure that, I mean, I do the same thing. If I just put myself inside a cabinet right now, this is me inside a loudspeaker cabinet, and that's me outside a loudspeaker cabinet. And hopefully you can hear a state of change when I'm inside and when I'm outside, right?
Absolutely.
So we try to minimize those effects using a variety of different processes. The one you can see over my shoulder is by far the most extreme because it uses complex curvatures, as you can see. Those complex curvatures increase the stiffness of the cabinet massively because we're using, in this particular case, 18 layers of beech wood, which are formed under pressure, in this particular case, under 80 tons of pressure in a press tool. Heated to 90 degrees and then kept in place for 20 minutes. And they come out and they form this incredible, extreme curved bonded construction that you can see there. The top element, the one that the silver cone lives in, we refer to as the turbine head, is not wood, it's aluminium, and it's a single piece casting of 18 kilograms of solid aluminium. So again, not for the faint of heart, this is not simple technology, but it produces a much more inert construction, inert as in stiff, as in less likely to vibrate. And also, as you can see, because of its form, because of its shape, it really minimizes that effect. It pulls back on all of the cabinet that it possibly can around the edges of the cone. And as a result of that, the energy that the cone generates goes out into the room really well. The most iconic of all the technologies is the one right at the top, the tweeter on top. And that's something that we deploy on quite a few products, and not just on 800s. We use that in our car audio. We use that in our TV audio. And we also use it on more affordable ranges of loudspeakers in the stereo sense, like our 700 series. And that's the apogee of that same idea of taking the minimum amount of material around the cone, in that particular case, the tweeter, and then putting it into its own separated enclosure. And that one on an 800 is milled from a solid billet. So it's just under a kilogram of solid aluminium.
Mm-hmm. And how about the diamond tweeter, though? You have to tell us about the diamond tweeter.
Yeah, okay. So let's talk about, okay, cone philosophies. Yeah. Everybody's heard the word distortion. We all know the word distortion, right? Mm. Now, distortion isn't just an expression. It's literal. If a structure that's moving forwards and backwards in the room is making an unwanted movement, as it does so, the sound that it generates will also be unwanted. It will also be distorted. I can really simply do that just by distorting my own mouth, and suddenly I sound weird, right? So what we're trying to achieve with a cone is that as it moves forwards and backwards, remember it's moving at high frequency in the case of the tweeter, several thousands of cycles per second. We don't want it to flop and round, bend. We want it to stay in shape, avoid distortion. So we use a variety of different materials and material types to try and achieve that. On our more affordable loudspeakers, we use aluminium. And on our mid-range loudspeakers, we use aluminium coated in a carbon coating, which stiffens them up. We refer to that as the carbon dome. And on these guys, on the 800s, we use diamond. And obviously people kind of go, really? No, really. It's artificially grown. It's formed under pressure. It's done for us by a company called Element 6, who are part and parcel of De Beers Group. It's RIP, but we work very closely with them to manufacture there in Ascot in the UK. And essentially, you're taking carbon particles and injecting them into a very high pressure chamber, I mean like volcanic heat, and then forming, accelerating the forming process of diamond in a very, very fine 30 micron thick, which isn't thick at all, by the way, that's just several human hair, membrane of artificially grown diamond. Now, the reason for doing that, of course, is diamond is the stiffest material that there is. As a result, it's incredibly good at resisting that unwanted bend and flex. And that makes it incredibly good at delivering high frequencies accurately. You're going to ask now, why use different material types? So I'm going to try and explain that if I can. If you accept that the upper limit of hearing for somebody with fully functioning hearing is 20 kilohertz, which is 20,000 cycles per second. That's a very high sound, by the way. Not a lot of people will hear it. Certainly older men like me probably can't. But let's say that it's 20,000 cycles per second. If you just designed a dome to hit that point and no more, you wouldn't have any headroom in the system, number one. But more importantly, as you get close to the point where you're hitting the limit of the system, it starts to get into stress. And I can give you an analogy of that. If you designed a car that could only do 100 miles an hour, and then you tried to drive that car at 99 miles an hour, you can imagine that the gearbox would be screaming and there'd be smoke pouring out from the dashboard and the car would be wheeling across the road. And it would be because it's essentially approaching the limits of its engineering capability. Yeah. So what we found over time is if you raise the threshold point, you push away the point where the dome is starting to get into distress beyond the point where you can hear anything, you actually find as you get close to those limits, it's behaving completely benignly. To use the car analogy, you're now driving a Bugatti Veyron at 100 miles an hour. And of course, that's nowhere near the limit of the Bugatti. And as a result, your driving experience is completely serene. So we don't design domes to hit 20 kilohertz. We design them to hit higher. Our most affordable ones will hit 38, our mid-range one will hit 47, and this one will hit 72 before it starts to distress. That's 72,000 cycles per second. Now, to be clear...
Can dogs even hear that?
No, to be clear, you definitely can't. You definitely can't. But what that means is in the audible range where you can hear, the dome is not even close to stressed.
Yeah.
And as a result of that, it's behaving benignly. And as a result of that, the resolution within the system is increased and you can hear that.
Well, that's a fantastic description. I think now is a good time to kind of walk through. There's three kind of main series of Bowers and Wilkins loudspeakers, the 600 yeah. series, 700 and 800, the 800 being the ones behind you.
Yeah.
Could you tell us why there's three different series and what the major differences are?
Sure. Let me show you some images. Maybe that will help. If I just share my screen 1 second, that obviously is the Nautilus you saw from before, but let's go to a couple down the line. There we go. So that's the 600 series. Let's begin with that. That's our affordable range, as it says there, affordable performance. So you can't use 18 kilogram lumps of solid aluminium in a product and make it affordable, funnily enough. Mm-hmm. So there are certain choices that you have to take, engineering choices, manufacturing choices, in order to hit certain price points. Now, we want with the 600 series to deliver something that's still great, that's still, you know, fantastic to listen to, still enjoyable, still engaging. But clearly, we have to pull back on other things. So there are no diamond tweeters in this product, again, obvious reasons, because these start at around the £450 mark. For a pair, by the way, you get for that money. Construction, it's MDF, it's a mighty wooden joint MDF box. Reasonably well made, of course, we'd like to think, but it doesn't have that curved cabinet construction, all those other things, because that is outside the scope for the price point. But it does have the continuum cone, that silver cone, that mid-range cone, mm-hmm. which is the one that you saw in the 800 series that we mentioned earlier on, because that's our proprietary comb technology. We developed that for the 800 series back in 2015, and then we spent the last 4 years, 5 years cascading it down into all of our other ranges of loudspeaker. It's something that's unique to us, something that's manufactured here in the UK, in Dell Road, in our factory around the corner, and something we believe really gives us a performance advantage. So essentially, from a 600 perspective, the story here is you're getting a loudspeaker that's got elements of the technology within it that come from an 800, but at a much more affordable price point. Yes, inevitably, there are certain compromises. It, like I said, doesn't have some of those more exotic materials, but it still has some really good materials within it that give it a kind of competitive advantage, we'd like to think, in the space that it lives in. And this comes in stand mount models and tower models, so ranging between 450 up to around 1500 quid mark.
Well, that's a great way for people to get into it too, and not have
absolutely. And again,
have great performance.
It's the whole idea again is absolutely that. I think, you know, you have to recognize that if you only made products that you know, the very well heeled or the utterly dedicated audiophile could afford or would want to buy, you probably would have a much more limited audience. So, you know, we want to bring people in at the, you know, the younger ages, 25s to 35s, and kind of get them hooked on it, and then maybe one day they will move up through the ranges. Our step up is 700 series. 700 series starts to bring in some of the elegance in design and detail, the finish. As I say, I don't think 600 series is by any means ugly, but it's definitely more affordable. It has to be. With 700 series, you start to get into, you know, gloss veneers, as you can see here in the case of this particular model. But what it also does is it brings in more technology. So it starts at around the £800 mark for a small pair, the 707s, goes up to 4,500 for the largest pair, the 702. And that introduces, as you can see there, the tweet on top construction, which is one of those primary technologies that we spoke about earlier, taking the high frequency and putting it into its own separated enclosure. So this is it's our middle range. It covers a broad gamut. It's, as I say, a step up in terms of capability, cabinet construction, technologies, but it's still fundamentally a box, because ultimately you're still producing a more affordable product. And then from there,
great photo as well. Is that Abbey Road?
Yeah, that's the control room, Studio One.
I've been there.
And then we're looking through the window in Studio One. And yeah, 800 series diamond, which is our flagship range. And that goes from £4,500 a pair to £22,500 a pair. And there's a pair of them over the shoulder from me as well, going back on the point. So they are no holds barred, really. We you know, whereas clearly we're designing, as I mentioned earlier on, to hit certain price points, and that in turn maybe drives certain choices with something like a 600, and rightly so. With an 800 series diamond, we don't really have many constraints to be concerned about. So we can push the boat out and do what we want, and we try.
They're wonderful loudspeakers. And they have a real cultural significance too.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things I find so fascinating about 800 is that contribution that it's made to the fabric of society culturally across decades now. I mean, we first came out with it. Bowers and Wilkins, by the way, is remarkably literal sometimes in the way that model names come up, right? So it's called the 800 series because it began with a model called the 801. Mm-hmm. It was developed in 1979, and it was designed to be the first loudspeaker for 1980.
Wow.
That's where the name comes from.
Oh, 801. Wow.
That's as simple as that.
That's simple.
We'll say it's quite simplistic. Guess which one? We had a model that came out in 1970. Would you like to guess what it was called? It was called
the M70. The 500s.
Exactly.
Sorry.
So DM70. So we're literal like that sometimes. But yeah, 801 has been around a long time, and in its time, it's been in dozens of different recording studios across the world, including places obviously as famous as Abbey Road Studios in the UK. But also, 20th Century Fox scoring stages use it in California, in Culver City. Obviously, Skywalker Ranch in Marin County, California, they use it as well. Boston Symphony Orchestra uses it.
Oh, wow.
There are lots of different strong room. We've been in different places all over the world at different times. And as a result of that, there's a very good chance, if you've listened to most or some of the most significant recordings of the last few decades, whether it's music or film, you probably at some point or another listened to something that was first heard first ever replayed on a pair of 800s or an 800 series range of loudspeakers. It's something that's used to kind of contribute to the fabric of society. We've got great images of, you know, George Lucas and John Williams in the control room in Studio One, kind of listening to the first rushes of the sound for Star Wars, The Phantom Menace, or, I mean, you know, Return of the Jedi was done on it. Avengers, Lord of the Rings, 1917. 800s were there for all of that.
And well, I guess the design's doing something right then.
Yeah, absolutely. But it's great from our perspective. It obviously, you know, makes us all sort of stand a bit taller and feel a bit better. But I think that's also going back on that point, I think I said a little bit earlier on, you know, we never forget what we're doing this for, if you see what I mean. Yes, so the whole idea at the end of all of this is you, hopefully you specifically, but everybody, buy these things to listen to music or watch films, which also contains music, by the way. Mm-hmm. You don't buy them for their own right. I mean, they are wonderful bits of engineering, I'd like to think. And maybe you like the way they look. I happen to. Some people don't, but that's okay.
Yeah.
But ultimately, if they're doing their job, they're not there with you, and the performance that you care about is.
Absolutely. I'm going to put out one more shout out for anyone who wants to ask a question. Please press the Q&A, because we have about 15 minutes left. So while we wait for some questions to come in, I have a question as well. We should speak about formation, and we should speak about streaming as well, because some people want that capability. And Bowers and Wilkins makes products that do that.
Yeah, well, I mean, you have to recognize the way the modern world's going, right? There's a great story from my youth. A journalist, Malcolm Stewart, wrote a brilliant article about him. I think it was in the early 90s, about when he bought home his umpteenth high-end CD player. And his then young son kind of walked in and went, "What's that?" And he said, "It's a CD player." And obviously it was a kind of wacky looking piece of equipment. And he kind of went, "Well, what else does it do?" And that's when Malcolm said in the article, that's when it dawned on him that, you know, he was living in a new generation now, where to the kid, you know, that little silver disc did more than just play music. It was the advent of like data and video CD and then PlayStation and then DVD and then everything else, right? We have to recognize in 2020 that, you know, kids, younger people are growing up in a world where hard media, whatever it might be, is increasingly rare. I mean, it's interesting, isn't it, that vinyl's having a resurgence. Mm-hmm. For me, it never went away. But I can't remember personally the last time I bought a CD. And I think that's very true of that younger generation, because why would they? You know, the content in their world is that, isn't it? And it lives on that. So if we buried our head in the sand and chose not to make devices that recognize that reality, we'd very quickly go the way of the dodo, I think. You know, you do have to recognize that to the modern consumer, streaming is an entirely legitimate way of enjoying music. A mobile device is an entirely legitimate music source. And it's on us from an engineering perspective to try and do that job to the very best of our ability, to try and make the most of that experience. Now, happily, running in parallel to the work that we and obviously others in our industry have been doing, music streaming services themselves have also been greatly improving the offering that they have. You know, the quality of streaming and the quality of download today compared to the infancy of MP3 and all that kind of stuff is vastly improved. And there's a whole series of different providers now offering high resolution music streaming of really high quality. You can also, if you choose to still download it and own it, buy it in high resolution too. So all of those things have enabled a significant improvement. I don't think in 2020, wireless audio necessarily has to connote compromise or mean, you know, you're not an audiophile anymore. Now, with all of that in mind, we initiated a project back in 2013 to try and fuse all of those things together in a way that could produce a loudspeaker or a series of loudspeakers that we felt lived up to our expectations for sound. And obviously, as we spoke about earlier on, we're quite demanding. The interesting thing is when you go to the point of an active wireless loudspeaker, again, the immediate reaction is horror from certain audiophiles, but actually the reality is you gain control over lots of things. So if we just make the loudspeaker and nothing else, let's say those, mm-hmm. we've got no way of knowing what kind of amplifier you're going to buy, what kind of cables you're going to have, or what kind of source you're going to have. You should have good stuff in all cases, but there's nothing to say you don't buy those and then connect them to a 20-year-old amplifier that you found in the loft that only has marginal power, and then plug it into some, you know, Danset record player or something like that, and that's you. With an active wireless loudspeaker, we regain a ton of control. We have a ton of control over all of those things. So we can specify the amplifier, the output. We can specify the DSP, the EQ. We have full control over the digital to analog conversion, the input pathway. We can even, in modern versions, you know, attempt to try and decode audio directly on board, you know, through platforms such as Spotify Connect. And as a result of that, you can actually deliver much more. You actually have much more control. I think the really interesting next step, and obviously something that quite a few brands, including us, are looking at, is how we can then use that power and that brain to make the speaker a little bit more sentient. And I don't mean Alexa sentient, I just mean aware of the room that it's in and try to optimize itself to the space that it's in to try and produce even better results for that space. Going back on how we started this conversation, right? Every room has its issues. An active wireless loudspeaker is probably the best tool developed, assuming it's got the right capability on board, for most consumers most of the time, to really optimize the speaker to the space they're in.
Okay, well, I have one last question, and it's more of a personal question. Mm-hmm. Which album do you recommend people to listen to that you think has really wonderful sonics, but that you just love? It's not because it just happened, you know, I'm not saying to judge it on the sonics, but just an album that you absolutely adore that you think just sounds great.
Okay, you're going to ask the hardest question of the lot at the end, right?
I'm not asking for your favorite. That's okay. Just anything that comes, like if I just was talking right now, just one that comes to mind would be Mezzanine by Massive Attack on vinyl, original pressing. Oh my gosh, it's divine. Yeah, but I'm not saying it's my favorite album. I'm just saying just came up on the top of my head.
Okay, so I'm going to go Floyd, Dark Side of the Moon. And the reason for that is a lot of engineers, a lot of studios, it was recorded at Abbey Road for like those of you guys.
Alan Parsons Engineering as well.
And in those days, a lot of the time, people would go in for like a week or 2 weeks or 3 weeks. I mean, you know, even the Beatles didn't stay that long. And Floyd were different. They basically booked the space for like months and just try stuff out, right? And try new things. And in the case of that particular recording, they were just, you know, noodling and doing incredible different things. I tell you what, also, actually, I'm going to give it a close second. In my particular track, it's a different Floyd album. It's Wish You Were Here. So I love Shine On You Crazy Diamond. Okay, so Shine On You Crazy Diamond was recorded inside Studio One, Abbey Road Studio One, or the opening sequence was. Most of the rest of it was done in three. And the reason it's incredible is because in the period when it was done, the desk, the recording desk, the consoles, didn't have the reverb time that the creative intent required. So to achieve it, they basically took Gilmour and stuffed him in the middle of this vast space. For those of you who've seen it, I'm sure you'll know what I'm talking about. Studio One is massive. Mm. It's big enough to hold a complete orchestra.
Orchestra, yeah.
And they put him right in the middle, and then they stuck all the mics at the end, and then he played that kind of haunting, melancholic kind of guitar. And of course, because the mics are big and the room's big, the room's big, that's how you get that sound. Of like the. So all of that's translated into the experience. You even on small speakers, even in a relatively compact room, you can hear the room, you can hear the sense of the studio, and you can hear the scale of the sound. And it's phenomenal. I mean, it's an unbelievably immersive, almost three-dimensional picture just coming from two speakers. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you don't necessarily have to like Pink Floyd to get it, but I think if you wanted one track, I'm going to go Shine On You Crazy Diamond. there you go. That's very specific. And you could play that on our smallest stereo pair and be blown away. You can play it on a TV that we do and be blown away. You play it on these and close your eyes, and you're back in the vast confines of Studio One, hearing the whole height of the room, the whole width of the room, the whole depth of the room, coming into the space that you're in. And it does kind of, say, take you into a completely different environment.
Wow. Well, thank you so much, Andy, for your time tonight. It's been really eye-opening. You've explained things so well so that everybody can understand. The analogies have been fantastic. We've all got to learn more about Bowers and Wilkins' iconic designs, which is, you know, they are stunning just to even look at. But when you listen to them, you know why they perform. You know, you can really hear the way the music, the way the artist intended. I mean, that's what you're trying to get to. So thank you so much, Andy, for joining us.
You're very welcome. Thank you very much for having me.
And thanks to all of you patrons for attending. And thanks again for your support. A happy 10th anniversary to Classic Album Sundays as well. And thank you all. And thanks for listening. Take care.